What a blessing to know how much God really do love us and care about us. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to read to you this morning from the book of Philippians for today's message, and some and also in the gospel. We'll just stick with the book of Philippians for now. Philippians chapter 3. Read verses 7 through 12. Philippians 3, 7 through 12. Give her time to get off the pulpit, right? It's all right. Verse 7. It's Paul speaking. He said, "But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I followed after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus." I want to use verse 10 as our text, where he said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. And that's what I want to use for a title this morning, the power of his resurrection. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Marvin, would you please pray?
Father, thank you for our pastor. Thank you for his soul that's present. Father, touch each one heart according to their individual needs. Father, let us take this message, apply it to our life, and do all things pleasing in your sight. Give you the honor and glory. Father, bless the message and the messenger. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Amen. I want to preach about the power of his resurrection. I know it's a basic topic. And we all know about the resurrection of Jesus, right? But this is what I felt the Lord laid upon my heart to preach about, and we just come prepared. We don't know who's going to be here, right? Sometimes God surprises or sends us people. And who knows? Somebody online may not know fully the extent of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So though it may be simple this morning, just hear me out. Y'all with me, right? You can hear me out? All right. Because to be honest, really, if we can truly and fully understand the resurrection of Christ and what it's all about, it really will transform our lives. And we see this in the Bible, in the gospel. Like I said, we'll get back to this passage of scripture, the verse that I read to you, where the Apostle Paul making this declaration, he said, I want to know the power of his resurrection. Well, there was a story in the gospel, and you all know it, about we refer to it as the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus took three of his disciples. He took Peter, James, and John, and the Bible said he went up into a mountain, and while he was praying, he began to change. He began to, his looks began to change right before their eyes. His clothes became white, brilliantly white, that they have never seen white like that before. And the Bible said he was shining with the glory of God, and while he was there, the scripture said that that Moses represented the law, and Elijah the prophet, representing the prophets of the Old Testament, the messengers of the Old Testament, they appeared to him, and they were talking with Jesus, and the scripture said the disciples saw it. They witnessed the power that was happening. This was something they have never experienced before. We know that they experienced great power through the miracles of Jesus Christ. They have watched him turn water into wine. That itself is kind of cool, right? They've seen him heal people that were crippled and people that were blind and different miracles that he performed. So they were not unaware of the power of Christ. They were not ignorant of the things that he could do. They saw him, you know, walking on water and raising the dead back to life. And so they were fully aware of the power of Christ. But the scripture said when they saw this event, as they witnessed Christ in a glorified form, and no doubt Moses was glowing and Elijah was glowing because they came in a resurrected form also. And they were watching this. The Bible said they began to marvel of this. And they began to think about it, and they said it this way in Mark chapter 9, verses 9. Where was I? How do I get there? I need to get over here. I thought I had it marked. I thought I had marked, but I guess not. But I can flip to it. In Mark chapter 9, it's probably up there, right? I hope. Did I give you guys a scripture? Mark chapter 9, verse 9. He said, and as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. And they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one with another what the rising of the dead should mean. So here they witness something wonderful, something great. They witness the resurrection of Jesus, and this was something that troubled them. This was something that caused them to reason within their heart. You know, it was a life-changing situation. Despite of all the things they saw that Christ did and all the mighty miracles and the things they read about or heard about in the Old Testament that the prophets did and different miracles and stuff like that, this event had a lasting impact on their life. This resurrection, this thing that to see what it will be like in the afterlife, what men will look like, what people will look like, what God will look like in the fullness of his glory. It had a tremendous impact on their life to where the Bible said they questioned, they reasoned, man, what is it going to be? What's in store for us is what they were asking. You know, what is in store for us? We believe in God. We have faith in Jesus Christ. We accept him as our Lord and Savior. As Paul was saying here in our Bible reading, he said, I count all these things loss. And in other words, all the things that men are working to gain and all the things that people would hope to gain in life when it comes to religion, when it comes to status, when it comes to financial things and material things. He said, I count everything loss for the excellency of the knowledge of God. And he said, I want to know what the power of this resurrection is. In other words, he said, there is nothing in this world that could be compared to the afterlife. There is nothing in this world that can be compared to the glory. As you later on will write, he said, brethren, he said, no suffering can be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. Think about it this morning, what is in store for you. Think about what the resurrection will mean for you. Think about what it will be like to live in heaven, to live beside God, to live in the presence of God, in the fullness of the glory of God. What would this be like? You know, this is something that we should think about more often. Because if we think about heaven more often, then our mind will not be on earthly things as much. If we elevate our mind and focus on the resurrection, then that will be the focus of our living. You know, thank God for everything we have to do and things that we may accomplish in this life. But as the song said, I'm living this life just to live again. Right? I'm serving God just to live again. There's only two destinations. One, I don't want to go to. The other one, I'm looking forward to. Right? And so that's what happened when they saw what happened, when they got a glimpse of the resurrection. They're like, man, what is this going to be like? What power is going to be revealed in our life that day? It was something that caused them to first time, I understand there are other times in scripture when Jesus calmed the raging sea. And they said, what manner of man is this? That even the wind and the sea obey him. That kind of shook them a little bit, right? Who is this that we're following that can speak peace to a raging sea, that can cause a storm, that can bring such peace in the midst of a storm? Who can do this but God, right? And that kind of shook them a little bit. But this, what they saw on the mountain, was different. This, what they experienced on the mountain, was different. It was on a different level to where when they saw it, Peter said, Lord, it's good for us to be here. Right? He said, I don't want to leave. This is great. This is incredible. This is wonderful. I've never experienced anything like this in my life. I just want to live on this mountain forever. That's the kind of experience the resurrection had on him. That's the kind of an impact the resurrection, the fullness, or just to get a glimpse of the resurrection had on this man, that he said, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Let's just set up some tents and camp out here and don't even go back down. Let those people stay there. Let them fend for themselves. We can just live with God on the mountain. And you know, one of these days, that will be a reality. We can live with God on his mountain. Amen. We can live with God in his kingdom. We can live with God and enjoy the power and the presence of God and the goodness of heaven and the beauty of that city that the Bible's laid out in details for us, all the things that the Lord have in store for us. Heaven's going to be wonderful. Heaven's going to be great because the Lord has already prepared a place for his people. But we got to get a little curious sometime. You know, we got to get a little bit curious. What is this resurrection all about? What does this resurrection mean to me? Am I willing to lay down my life and make sacrifice and serve God to be a part of this resurrection? You see, there's two resurrections that will take place. The Bible said the first resurrection and the second resurrection. The first resurrection speaks about those that are saved, those from the beginning of times until the coming of the Lord, until Jesus wrapped up his church and, you know, began to deal with the Jews and the Antichrist and all that stuff. All those saints from the beginning to that point that are saved, that made it in, that had their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life, they are part of the first resurrection. The second resurrection is what we don't want to be a part of. That's the resurrection where all the ungodly will be resurrected. And they will have to stand before the white throne judgment of God, and they will be cast as they've been pronounced. Their judgment will pronounce upon them, and God will read their record of ungodliness and their degree of punishment that will be dished out. And the Bible said God will violently cast them into the lake of fire, which is the second death. So we understand there are two resurrections that will take place, but the one we want to focus on is the first one. We want to make the first resurrection. We want to make the first resurrection. We don't want to miss out on the glory of God. They were drawn, no doubt, to the power that they experienced. Like I said, no doubt, they have experienced many of the great miracles of Christ. They've experienced all his working to heal, to defy nature in many cases, to turn things around and change things and all the stuff. They've experienced that kind of power of God, and that was great and wonderful, baffles their mind. But this resurrection was a different story. This resurrection, this glory that they saw. You know, sometimes, you know, there are certain things that happen in our life that can change us forever. This was a turning point in their life. Because Peter wrote about it later on. He said, we heard the voice of God when we were up there in the mountain. We saw the glory of God when we were in the mountain. We're not telling you idle tales. We're not bringing to you something that we made up, some cunningly devised fables. We're not preaching to you some gospel that we came up with it in our mind. He said, we heard the voice of God. We saw the glory of God. The things that we're testifying to you, these things are real. And there is some power that is involved in it. There is some power that goes along with this glorification, this resurrection. And that's what the Apostle Paul was referring to here when he said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. You see, Paul, the Apostle, was one of them also that was caught up to the third heaven. He saw the glory of God. He saw Christ resurrected men. That's how he came in contact with Christ in the beginning. He saw the light that shone round about him on the road to Damascus. And he heard the voice of Christ saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Why are you fighting against me? Don't you know it's hard for you to kick against the pricks? So even the beginning of his journey started out in a miraculous way of a great experience with God. And then the Bible said later on, he was caught up to the third heaven and he heard things that was not lawful for a man to hear. He saw things that were not lawful for men to see. He got a glimpse of the glory of resurrection. He got a glimpse of what it's like to live in heaven. He got a glimpse of what it's like to be glorified. And then here he's writing, he said, I want to know Jesus and the power of his resurrection. There was something that was longing in his heart. Man, I just got a glimpse, but there is so much more. Amen. There is so much more to experience. There is so much more lit up in heaven for the people of God if they will just catch on fire, if they will just get a fire burning in their heart and work for God like they have a passion. Amen. Lay it all down on the altar. God is waiting for his people to catch on fire, to labor like they really believe in heaven, to work like they really believe in heaven, to have a desire to experience the power that will be revealed in us. Oh, God's people don't labor like they should. Oh, God's people don't pray like they should. God's people don't serve him like they should because they don't have the desire really burning in their heart to experience the power of the resurrection of Christ. There is so much power. We can experience some of the power in this life. Amen. But we got to put in the work. We got to put in the effort, amen. We got to give something to work with. You know, we can't give so much time to the world and then come on Sunday morning to preach and get 30 minutes with you to pump you up, you know, and to preach to you in 1 hour Sunday morning of worship. They got to be more, amen. You can't expect God to transform you and light a fire in your heart if that's all that is given. You got to be a Christian that have this desire like the Apostle Paul, that I may know him. Whatever it takes, I want to get to know God more and more and more in my life. I want to get this place in my life where I'm longing in my soul to experience the power of the resurrection of God. That's what it takes to transform life. A program is not going to do it, and then this is not going to do it. We really need a moment like the disciples had on the mountain. We need that moment in our life. The preacher is not going to do it. He can preach and preach and preach. You can bring the most anointed preacher in here. He's going to preach all he wants. If you get out of this church and don't change, he can't do it. Amen. The Holy Ghost is not even going to do it, able to do it if we don't let him do it. Jesus can't even do it if we don't let him do it. We are the one that have to get to the place in our life where we say, God, I want to know the power of your resurrection. I am longing in my soul to understand the fullness of the power of God's resurrection. We got to get to that place in our life. Amen. We got to get to that place in our life where we need to understand fully the resurrection of Christ. How many of y'all want to know the power? We got to know that power. We got to be drawn to that power. Amen. We got to be drawn to that power of your resurrection. You want to teach the little kids a little bit? You got a little girl back there. Hey, you come, we're going to feed you. You just teach them for a little bit. I'll preach. We have all day long today. I'll preach until tonight's service. You want to go? You want to go to Sunday school? Come on. You want to go to Sunday school over there? He's like, sure. All right, come on. Go. Be a leader. Rise up and they'll follow you. But there's something I want to focus on this morning. I want to focus on something special this morning. And that is the power of the resurrection. I want to focus on the power of the resurrection. We try not to yell and raise our voice, but it's in us. It's in us to preach with the power. We preach with conviction. We're not going to tell you some good story and let you fall asleep on us, right? But recently when my van got hit, they're giving me a rental car. They gave it a Dodge. Remember the Dodge I was driving out there, a Dodge Charger? Have a little sporty look to it. And so I was taking Miss Anna home on a Sunday night or whenever it was. And I pulled up into her area, and a whole bunch of little kids just ran up, and maybe, I don't know, 8 or 9 of them ran up to me. And they were just lusting after that car. They were lusting after it, a little boy, about 8 or 9. He got out of the car. You know when you rev an engine, you go, vroom, vroom, right? He's like, he ran up to me and said, hey, that's a nice car, man. I love it. It's nice. He said, does it go vroom, vroom? I said, well, I guess it goes vroom, vroom. I said, I haven't tried it yet, but I'm sure it goes vroom, vroom. And as I was walking about, he said, does it go vroom, vroom? He keep asking the same thing. Does it go vroom, vroom? I said, yeah, it goes vroom, vroom. So I dropped Miss Anna off, and he was just long. He was just looking at that car. And as I was walking by, I keep asking, does it go vroom, vroom? I said, yeah. I say, man. I say, when you get old, you know, you do well and you know, get your life in order, you can have a better one than this. You know, you can have one that go vroom, vroom also. A nicer one than this. But then I was driving by, I was like, man, you know, there was something about this little child. He was drawn to something. He was drawn to the power. Right? He was drawn to the power of that engine. There was something about the vroom, vroom that he was drawn to. Because that's all he keep asking is, does it go vroom, vroom? You know, and I feel the presence of God is talking about this. You know, how many people will be drawn to Christ if they can see the vroom, vroom in our life, right? How many people will be drawn to church if they can see the vroom, vroom in the Christian, the spiritual power, what I'm talking about? You know, if they will see a Christian on fire, if they will see a Christian that is praying, a Christian that is longing after God, a Christian that is devoted to the work of God, devoted to reaching souls for Christ, a Christian that wants more, that are hungry for God, that will be like the Apostle Paul, that though he were caught up to the third heaven, and the Bible said, I'll read it to you again one more time. He said, but what things were gained to me, verse 7, but what things were gained to me, he said, those I counted loss for Christ. He said, nothing means more to me than Jesus Christ. Nothing means more to me than having a relationship with God, to know God. And not only to know Him, but to be drawn to the power of the resurrection of Christ. There is something wonderful about this resurrection power, to know that the God we serve could not be held by death. Amen. The cross couldn't stop Him. Death couldn't stop Him. Hell couldn't hold Him down. The grave couldn't keep Him in. No matter what they tried to do to Jesus, the Bible said after 3 days He rose again. Amen. He came out of that tomb resurrected with power, making a great declaration: all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. That's the power I'm talking about this morning. Does people see the resurrection power in our life? Are they drawn to that spiritual boom boom? Do they run after us and say, hey, man, what is so special about your life? I can see God in there. I can see your devotion, your dedication, your commitment. That no matter what you have to give up for God, it doesn't mean a whole lot to you. You know, sometimes all God is asking people to give up is their sin, that which is destroying them. Sometimes God is asking people to give up just a little bit more of their time to witness for Him, to spread His gospel. You know, I go out, you got a pastor that works, okay? I work throughout the week spreading the gospel. I go out in the morning, yesterday morning, spreading the gospel, give my family a break. I went back out in the evening spreading the gospel. Amen. I'm there working, right? I'm working for Jesus. Don't feel I'm not working. And when I'm not reaching out to new people, I'm visiting people that have been out, right? I'm working, okay? I'm working, so you can't say you don't have a good example of one that wants to do something for God, right? But we gotta catch on fire. We gotta catch on fire for Jesus. We gotta get to that place where we say, God, I want to know the power of your resurrection. You see what happened? Let me share. This is what I'm trying to share this morning. I say, preacher, what are you trying to share? Well, first thing I want you to leave with is people want to see that vroom vroom in your life. Doesn't that make sense? And they want to see that spiritual power in your life. But this is what happened when the disciples came down from the mountain. After they witnessed the resurrection of Jesus, they saw Him transform right before their eyes. They saw Him as He was glorified before them. Right? These were young men. Probably none of them older than me. Definitely not older than some of you. These were young men that Jesus called. Peter, James, and John. These were men that when they saw the glory of God, their life was changed forever. When they came down from that mountain, they never looked back. They never questioned anything. No matter what they had to go through, didn't matter to them. They threw them in prison, they came out shouting. The Bible said they rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for the name of Jesus Christ. They beat them, that didn't stop them. They called them liars, they called them children of the devil, didn't stop them. They went everywhere preaching the gospel. Amen. The Apostle Peter was one of them. He preached everywhere. He preached in Jerusalem. He preached in Antioch. He preached everywhere to the point the Bible said they crucified him upside down. You know why they crucified him upside down? Because they were getting ready to crucify him right way. Like this. But he said, I'm not even worthy to die like Jesus died. Just turn me upside down and crucify me upside down because I'm not even worthy to mimic Christ in my death. His life was changed forever all the way to the end. Amen. That's what the power of resurrection will do. When we fully understand the power of resurrection, no matter what we have to give up, no matter what we have to go through, no matter what we have to invest in the gospel of Christ, it will mean nothing to us because we know there a greater glory awaits us. Amen. Oh, people, God's people, oh, Christians, can you not long to experience more of God in your life? Can you not long to burn with that holy fire in your soul? Oh, God's people, can you not long to do more for the Lord? To be a light that people will be drawn to the power in your life. To where people will be drawn to the victories that you show them. That when you go through adversity, they will still see a smile in your face. They will not hear complaints and whinings and everything else. They will hear, oh, God brought me through this. Amen. And you will be a voice that will share the goodness of Christ. A voice that will tell people, will preach, look for opportunities every day. God, how can I witness to one person? He said, they will not come to church. I witness to thousands of people that don't come to church. That doesn't mean that God doesn't want me to talk to them. Right? I might be preaching about it tonight. He said, the light of the world. Right? He said, ye are the light of the world. Are we shining with the glory of God? Are we sharing the light of Christ? Am I doing all right this morning? Can people still run up to you and say, hey man, does your life go boom, boom? I like that. I love that. Maybe you didn't take anything away from this service this morning. Can people see the spiritual voom voom in your life? Are they drawn to that spiritual power? Are they drawn to that where Christ is working in you? The change that took place in these apostles' life as they saw the resurrection. The change that took place in Paul's life as he witnessed the resurrection of Christ. He said in verse 8, he said, yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. For whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. See what happened once he experienced that resurrection? He said, I don't care what I have to give up. I don't care what I lose. I don't care what I have to lay aside. He said, making it to heaven is more important. He said, seeing Christ is more important. The apostle, if you read on later on, in I think it's 1 Corinthians 10, he said, the grace that was bestowed upon me. He said, because of that grace, he said, I labor more abundantly. This was a man that was beaten for preaching the gospel 5 times. 40 stripes save one. That's 39 stripes. And these were not little, go get a whip and let me just hit you like that. Come on now. His body was ripped to shreds for the gospel of Jesus Christ. He spent time in the deep. He was 10 days in that storm, Acts chapter 27. Caught up in that storm while everybody was panicking and despair for life, this man was praying. They were drawn to the power of Paul. Amen. He said, amen, be of good comfort, be of good cheer. For the angel of God stood beside me and tell me everything's going to be all right. And I believe him. I believe him. They were drawn to that power. They went into that island and Paul, a prisoner, was liberating them. was setting them free, was showing them the power and the glory of God. What I'm talking about tonight, the power of the resurrection. He said, "Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ Jesus, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him." Listen to how he closes up. "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection." Despite all the things that Paul saw, all the things that he experienced, he said the resurrection is what I'm focusing on. There is some power about this resurrection. There is something intriguing about this resurrection. There is something that was calling on him, was drawing him. Man, I got to be a part of that resurrection. I got to be a part of that first resurrection. I must be a part of that resurrection. I want it. Amen. I want it. The only way we will be a part of that resurrection, the first resurrection, is we got to get saved. We got to get saved, because Paul told us later on, here he said in Corinthians, I read it to you, we're getting ready to close it here in just a moment. I read some verses. Y'all don't mind some Bible verses, right? In where am I? I'm still in the first page. That's where I am. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we read verse 17 through 20. Just give me a few more minutes of your time. But there was a turning point in their life. Once they experienced the resurrection of Jesus, there was a turning point. They never went back. They never went back. You know, even when the flesh and they didn't know what to do, and then they tried to go back to their old life, to go back to fishing and everything, and Jesus showed up, they remembered that resurrection. And never again did they go back to that old lifestyle. Let's say, you know what? I'm going with Jesus all the way. That's what the reality of the resurrection will do. Once you get a glimpse and a full understanding of it, the power of it, you will lay your life down. Physically, spiritually, materially, whatever you have to give up, you say, I count it all but loss for the knowledge of Christ. Amen. You'll deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Jesus. Christians today do not deny themselves and take up the cross and follow Jesus. God is waiting upon us to serve him. Y'all know this stuff. I'm not preaching things you don't know. Amen. How many of y'all believe you can do more for God? Right? We can all do more for God, right? How many of y'all know that God wants you to do more for him? Come on now. So I'm not telling you things that we don't know. We all know this stuff. We see, when you fully understand what's ahead of you, what's waiting for you, the resurrection, to be a part of that resurrection, you will jump all the way in. You'll say, forget what was behind me. And that's what he said in Philippians, forgetting those things which are behind me and pressing for those things which are before me, right? But listen to what he said in verse 17 of 1 Corinthians 15. He said, and if Christ be not raised, speaking about the resurrection, he said, your faith is vain. You are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ Jesus are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. You know, he said, man, there is a resurrection for the people of God. There is something awaiting us, people. There is something glorious, things that these apostles experience. Paul experienced it. Peter, James, and John experienced it. They saw the glorification. And the Bible said they came down from that mountain and they began to reason, what does the rising from the dead will mean? They saw a little bit of it, but they wanted to know what power is involved in this resurrection. That's what they were drawn to. Amen. That's what Paul was drawn to. He said, the power of his resurrection. He said, there is some power in the afterlife. There is some power in being glorified with God. There is some unlimited power of being saved and being filled with the Holy Ghost. There is some power that God wants to reveal and fill his people with, not only in this life, but when we get to heaven, there is some power to be experienced. And he said, that's what I want to know. I don't want to shortchange myself and just give the bare minimum I don't want to be that Bible school student that give just three, that type just three pages of notes. I want to give it all. I want to work. I want to labor. I want to pray. I want to sacrifice. I want to give. I want to give of myself so that I can be counted worthy of the fullness of the resurrection of Christ. I want to make sure that I'm saved, that there's no sin in my life that will keep me out of the kingdom of God. I want to make sure that there's no disobedience in my heart, no hard-heartedness towards the Lord and towards the work of God. I want to make sure that I'm clear of anything between me and the Lord, coming before Him and making sure that my attitude towards God is right. You know, sometimes Christians can have a bad attitude towards God. Amen. I'm serious. Something can happen and it can trigger a bad attitude in us. And Paul referred to it as a root of bitterness. And he said that root of bitterness can grow up and it can trouble us if we are not careful. Amen. And we as Christians have to examine ourselves and say, you know what? Am I really experiencing the power of this resurrection in my life? Am I really being what God wants me to be? Am I really fulfilling God's purpose and God's will in my life? Is that resurrection power working in me? As he said in the book, you come, I read a few more scriptures. Romans 3:23 said, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." The Bible said, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." This resurrection power that these apostles experience really 100% transformed them. Really 100% caused them to lay it all down for Jesus. What would this resurrection power do in your life? If you could fully understand or even just get a glimpse of what it'd be like. What? Time for me to go to lunch. If you could understand the fullness of the power of the resurrection, would it really transform your life? Would it really cost you to lay it all down for Jesus? Would it really cost you to, as the scripture said, deny yourself and take up your cross and follow Him? What would the fullness of the power of the resurrection of Jesus do in your life? Would it cause you to forsake your sins and come to God and repent? Would it cause you to truly get saved one time in your life and say, "Jesus, I know what I need to do. I know I need to just get it all out of the way and make it right with You. And because I know You died on the cross for me and You rose again from the dead, and that resurrection power is able to transform my life fully, 100%. If you really understand the power of His resurrection, would you just turn your life over to God completely and say, "Lord, I will be Your servant. I will be a true servant of the living God"? What would you do if you understand the fullness of the resurrection of Christ? Would you search your heart and say, I'm weighing the balance, Lord, and I'm coming up short. I'm weighing the balance. The resurrection power is here, and I'm not balancing up, Lord. It's off. What would you say to your own life if you understand the fullness of the resurrection of Christ? Just like Peter, James, and John, and Paul, that got a glimpse of the true resurrected Christ. What would it do for you? What would it do to you? As you bow your heads and close your eyes in reverence to the Lord, what change will it bring about in your life? What transformation would it cause in you if you fully understand the resurrection of Christ? Would it cause you to go the extra mile? Would it cause you to forsake yourself and be what God wants you to be? What would this resurrection power accomplish in your life? What would it do for you as a child of God? Now that you understand some of the resurrection, what would it do in your life? As you bow your heads and close your eyes, she's gonna play and sing. Let's find a place to pray. Ask yourself this question: what is this resurrection power doing in my life? And you can come to the altar. The altar is open. It's a place of prayer. It's a place of laying it down before the Lord. It's a place of commitment to God. It's a place where we say, Lord, I know fully I'm not measuring up to that power that's supposed to be working in me. I'm not measuring up. And Lord, I want your help this morning. God will help you. God will help you. If you take that step of faith and say, God, I want to know you and the power of your resurrection. Jesus, I preach your word this morning. I pray that people will be drawn to you and to your power, and that you will speak to them by the Holy Ghost. As we commit the service in your hand, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's all find a place to pray this morning.
Take my life, a living sacrifice, knowing it's the least that I can do. Make my life a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. Thank you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I guess you stop playing. I got to start talking. Let there be some spiritual boom boom in our life. The power of His resurrection. Let it change you, like it did for the apostles, for all that experience it. It transformed their life, and it can transform all of our lives if we get that burning fire in our heart to know more about it. Amen. God bless you. We'll be in service tonight, 6:30. I encourage you to come back. Let's worship God one more time on this Lord's Day, and we'll see what the Lord has in store for us. And Marvin, would you close us this morning?
Father, thank you for all that was accomplished in this service this morning. Father, keep